It's time for Twit. This Week in Tech, Harry McCracken is here. So is Jason Hiner, Ed Bott. And I'm glad because these Windows experts are going to explain what the heck is Microsoft up to with Windows 10. It's coming up next on Twit.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. It's time for Twit's annual audience survey, and we want to hear from you. Please visit twit.tv/survey and let us know what you think. It only takes a few minutes, and your anonymous feedback will help us make Twit even better. We thank you so much for your continued support. twit.tv/survey. This is Twit, This Week in Tech, episode 502, recorded Sunday, March 22nd, 2015. Call a booty. This Week in Tech is brought to you by Citrix GoToMeeting, the powerfully simple way to meet with coworkers and clients from the convenience of your computer, smartphone, or tablet. Share the same screen and see each other face-to-face with HD video conferencing. For a 30-day free trial, visit GoToMeeting.com today. And by Harry's. For guys who want a great shave experience for a fraction of what you're paying now, go to harrys.com. Get $5 off your first purchase by entering the code TWIT5 when you check out. And by Personal Capital. With Personal Capital, you'll get award-winning financial tools, unbiased advice, and a transparent view of all your investments. Best of all, it's free. To sign up, go to personalcapital.com/twit. And by Carbonite. For the hands-on business owner, Carbonite makes data backup hands-free. Carbonite's automatic cloud backup provides you with round-the-clock protection at work and at home. Visit Carbonite.com and use the offer code TWIT for 2 free bonus months. It's time for Twit This Week in Tech, the show where we cover the latest week's tech news. And we have a massively fine panel. I am surrounded by Ziff, former and present Ziff Davisers.
Not me.
You're IDG.
IDG.
The technologizer's here, Harry McCracken. He's now at fastcompany.com, at Harry McCracken. Great to see you. I've been following you've been Instagramming a lot of retro technology. It's been fun.
This place is great because every time I come, I go over
there
and take a picture of one or two things.
Leo's old crap. It's always good for a laugh.
Your pet and all that stuff.
Yeah. Also, Jason Hiner from Tech Republic. He's a Ziff Davisser, CBS Interactive.
ZDNet, yes, indeed.
I guess we don't call it Ziff Davis anymore. That implies
nobody
ownership.
Nobody ever remembers.
Yeah, I mean, nobody even knows.
People now, what does the ZD stand for? Yeah. I explain this a lot. Yeah,
that's interesting. Interesting. Great to have you, Jason. We'll talk about your new book in a little bit. It's very exciting. And the new chapter, is it out yet?
It is out. It just went live on Friday.
Perfect. New chapter. Perfect timing. It's Gina Trapani.
Gina Trapani, yes.
All right, that's exciting. And also, to my left, my old friend Ed Bott, formerly of PC World, but still of ZDNet.
Yep. Yes. ZDNet. So I've actually got the trifecta here. ZDNet, Ziff Davis, and IDG going way back.
Winner.
I can't hold a job, I guess. But
Well, I wrote for InfoWorld and Byte and Ziff Davis, so I think I'm in the same boat. I was never an editor like you. I was only a lowly minion.
You wrote for Byte?
One of my first reviews was a Macintosh review in the Mac issue of the Byte magazine in 1984.
Wow.
Yep. I'm an old
Isn't it
fart.
Great that we can always remember our first articles?
You never forget do you?
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wonder what prompted you guys to get into tech reporting. I got into it because I wanted to support my habit.
Me too.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. I think we're all kind of for the same reason.
My first piece was for Creative Computing, by the way.
Creative Computing, great magazine.
Like 1982, I think.
Great magazine. Loved Creative Computing.
Which was Ziff Davis at the time, so I take it back. I wrote for Ziff Davis, but...
And that was primarily an Apple II journal, right? But they did everything.
It was a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
Amiga.
Atari, too.
Atari.
Because I was an Atari guy. Mm-hmm. So. And Jason, what was your first piece?
Yeah, it was a piece on this little piece of software called Dave that you put on your Mac so that it could look like a Windows machine on a Windows network.
I remember Dave.
Oh, Dave, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yep, yep. I wrote a how-to. It was kind of about that piece of software, and then I wrote a little bit of a how-to, how to install it and awesome. Get it to work and all that stuff.
And never forget your first piece.
Yep, yep. Always.
And Ed, do you remember? You're the senior guy here, probably. You've been doing this longer than anybody. What year did you start?
Well, in the PC trade, I started in 87. I think
Harry's going to win.
Yeah, so it was at, well, before that, I was writing about semiconductor technology, manufacturing technology.
Ooh, that's nice.
And editing magazines for, people who worked in those clean rooms and wear the big dust protective suits and stuff. So I wrote articles about that. And thank God, whatever my first one was, is lost to the ages and brain cells.
Well, I don't know then. We don't know who wins.
Stuff.
We don't know who
super
wins here. Actually, it's appropriate because this month, GNU turns 30, and the GNU Manifesto, first published in Dr. Dobbs' journal, what would that be, 30 years ago, 1985. And actually, that'll tell you how far we've come. The New Yorker magazine has a profile of Richard Stallman.
Wow.
That would not have happened 30 years ago.
I'm surprised it happened today.
Probably not even 20 or 10.
Stallman, of course, the creator of the GNU project, GNU's not Unix. He was one of the original MIT hackers. Stephen Levy wrote about him in Hackers and is still around. I'm trying to decide whether I should try to get him on Triangulation
He's
or not.
He's such a nice person.
He's a sweetheart.
Really down to earth, not demanding in any way.
He has a 10,000-word rider for his appearances. I know, because we had him on Tech TV. One of the and by the way, he actually is a genuine, caring person, but he's a little prickly. I know you were being sarcastic, but I actually think when he plays the recorder and sings the free software song, he's a sweet guy.
He's made the world a far better place.
And he has contributed hugely to it.
I have some issues with anybody who says that somebody else's choice of technology makes them a prisoner, and that the real way not to be a prisoner is to use the same products that you want to use.
That's his philosophy.
I do bristle a little bit at his notion that anybody who's using software that doesn't meet his standards is a prisoner. Having said that, he's made my life better. He's made the life better of virtually anybody who uses software.
Linux wouldn't exist without the GNU project. Linux was a kernel. Yep. Linus Torvalds wrote the kernel, but without stuff on top of the kernel, you got nothing. And almost everything in most modern Linuxes is based on GNU. And in fact, it's kind of funny because I just got my Learning GNU Emacs book. This was Richard Stallman's, first well-known program was Emacs. And to this day, still widely used by hardcore geeks everywhere. Yeah. But Linux, which means if you use Android, you owe a great debt of gratitude to Richard Stallman.
Apache, which runs most of the
Apache.
Web. Yeah. Yep. What else? MySQL. Also open source.
If you start talking open source, man, then the world, yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
But at that point, as soon as you mention open source, Mr. Stallman.
There is a departure. Yeah, there is a departure there.
Free software.
It goes off.
Yeah, he founded the Free Software Foundation and created the GNU license, the GNU GPL, the GNU Public License. Which is in its third or fourth iteration. I remember interviewing Eben Moglen about this, the guy who, the lawyer who was behind it. And some call it a virus because it requires, if you use GNU free software, that you license it the same way it was licensed. So you have to give it away and you have to offer a source and so forth. I don't know. I have a huge admiration for Richard, but I don't know if I want to spend a lot of time getting him on the air. The writers is both interesting and unusual, let's say.
Is the TriCaster free software?
Yeah, we probably can't use the TriCaster. He prefaces every email he sends with these words, and I think we should all do the same. To any NSA and FBI agents reading my email, please consider whether defending the U.S. Constitution against all enemies, foreign or domestic, requires you to follow Snowden's example. Not sure even what that means. I get the gist of it. I'm considering right now. His 10,000-word rider according to the New Yorker, makes charmingly odd reading. He loves good food, folk dancing, and beautiful landscapes. He hates avocados, dislikes hotels, and is indifferent to wine. Also, don't buy him a parrot.
Right.
Man, who hates avocados?
Yeah, really. Actually, I remember in order to get him on Tech TV, because we did interview him on Tech TV, and I did get him to play the recorder and sing the free software song, which was a highlight of my career. He said, the day, I don't expect you to do this all the time, but the day I appear on Tech TV, no show can refer to Linux. It has to always be GNU Linux. That's his. That's one of his serious.
He's real fussy about the exact wordings of things in a way, which I don't think helps his cause.
Yeah. Anyway, amazing guy. And I noticed this New Yorker article refers to GNU Linux throughout. So I have a feeling that they signed the writer.
Yeah, just signed the waiver. Yeah, yeah.
Only Richard Stallman would say, okay, New Yorker, you could do a profile of me, but you got to call it GNU Linux. This is a man who's pure of heart.
Yeah.
Pure of purpose. 30 years ago this month, GNU, the GNU Manifesto was published. I thought we'd mention that as we began the show. Let's see. You know, I've been out of town for a couple of days. Did anything happen this week? Anything important? Windows 10 coming out this summer. Although, as Paul Thurrott quickly pointed out, summer could be any time between June 20th and September 20th. Yeah. So they had originally say Windows 10 would be this fall, but it still could be, in a way, you know, late 2015.
Did they ever actually say fall, or did we assume fall?
I think they said fall, didn't they?
They said this year.
I think the most important thing about it was actually the story that Ed did about the fact that Microsoft's going to, make it available for free, even outside of China.
Yeah, they're going to basically say, even if you have a pirated version of Windows, Windows 7 or 8, we'll allow you to upgrade to Windows 10 for free.
Any version.
Yeah. Now, actually, that really does make it any version, because if you're running Windows 95, just steal a copy of Windows 7, and you can upgrade. This is, Ed, you've been covering Bill Gates and Microsoft for a while. This is a dramatic shift from the Bill Gates Microsoft.
It really is, although they're basically what they're trying to do here is just get out of the paid upgrade business, except among enterprise customers. They want this to be basically your last Windows upgrade ever, and then once that happens, you're just on a continuous servicing model. And they say it'll be free. You'll buy Windows. It'll just be included into the price of a new device that you get. But any upgrades, updates, new features, and everything, those will just appear through Windows Update. No more paying for upgrades.
I assumed more that it was, and maybe this is hand in hand with what you that it's really to reassure developers. Look, we're going to catch everybody up. We're going to make sure that the... Because right now, the majority of Windows users, I think, still use XP. Isn't it still more
seven,
than...
I think it's seven.
Seven? But XP is a significant percentage.
Higher-end businesses, I assume.
Yeah. So what Microsoft would love is to tell developers, look, everybody's going to use Windows 10. They're going to use this, which is good for developers because there's a unified development system. So you can write for any Windows 10 device. Right once, it works on Windows Phone, it works on Xbox One, it works on desktops, it works on tablets. Is this a message to developers?
I think that's part of it, but this is also a platform play. You know, I mean, they want that platform. They want the Windows platform to remain, the largest single computing platform in the world, which it, Android is creeping up, and then you also have Chrome making some progress. And I mean, the thing is they want Windows as a platform to remain relevant. It is big. It's significant that they are, giving up this sort of honeypot of software upgrades. You know, that's what's made Microsoft Microsoft. They extracted all that value out of the PC ecosystem, turned all the PC makers into, low margin providers of hardware. And they extracted all the value out of that ecosystem by making people pay for Windows, making the providers pay for Windows, and making users pay for Windows upgrades. But that ship has kind of left the station or left the port. And I think that Ed was saying, they're essentially giving up on that upgrade, that model. enterprises will still pay for upgrades because they'll still pay for software
and that's
insurance.
And that's got to be the bulk of the revenue is enterprise.
That's where a lot of the money is. Yeah, but for consumers, they will and small businesses too. They will no longer have to pay for Windows to have the platform. But the trade-off that Microsoft's making there is by having that platform be ubiquitous, then they can make money off of a software store, same way Apple does off of selling you software through the store, of selling, also media, movies and TV shows and books and those kinds of things. You know, they can make their cut off that. So, but in order to do that, you have to have a really big platform. The bigger your platform is, the more widespread it is, the more money you can make off of all of that stuff. And so that's the trade-off for something like this. I mean, the thing is, can you trade that platform? The platform has to get bigger and bigger and bigger and more widespread to make up for, all those sort of pennies that you make on those transactions. You have to, make up for a lot of software licenses that you're no longer kind of selling. But that's what that's my interpretation of where they're going with this.
It's kind of telling they did this in China, too. This was at WinHEC. In Shenzhen,
well, there's something
China.
There's something to back up a little bit there, too. And something you said, Leo, that I want to amplify a little bit. You said, doesn't XP still have a lot of usage? If you include China, it does.
Those users never paid for it, but they're using it, right?
Right. There are hundreds of millions. So, there's all sorts of squishy, wiggly, not very accurate statistics floating around about which platforms and which operating systems are being used. But when you get big numbers for Windows XP, in general, that is counting the pirate population in China. Now, there are also a lot of enterprises in the Western world, in the developed world, but for the most part, those companies are paying fairly hefty support contracts for the right to continue running a no longer supported operating system. But XP is shrinking very, very quickly. And Windows 7 right now, the whole thing with Windows 10 is to prevent Windows 7 from turning into the next Windows XP and having it in 2020.
Nobody ever upgrades.
Here we go again.
Yeah.
So that's what that's all about.
So XP has more market share than Windows 8 and 8.1 together. This is, there's a lot of different measurements. This is from net market share. This is probably close to the actual percentages. 55 or 56% Windows 7, 19% XP, 10% 8.1, only 3.558, which shows that in a way that the test that Microsoft did of getting people from move to 8 to 8.1 was a success. So maybe they sensed there that they could do better. By the way, Mac is next at 3.55%. So it's kind of way behind there. Windows Vista, 2.11%. And Linux, 1.5%. So unless you include Android, this is on the desktop. So by giving away Windows 10 and not caring whether you're upgrading a pirated copy.
They do care, but they're kind of grudgingly saying they will give it to you, but you're still a thief.
What do you have to say? You have to like admit it and then you get a free copy? I mean, what do you mean?
Actually, most of what I know of this, I know about by reading Ed's piece, so maybe Ed should talk about
it. Ed, what's the story here? They aren't going to verify that you're using genuine Windows, right?
Right. Previously, first of all, this is the first time that a major whole number release of Windows is going to be released through Windows Update. It will just show up. In fact,
bizarre.
It worked, but they're doing it right now with the Windows 10 preview.
Yeah.
You can sign up for the Insider program on Windows 7, and the Windows 10 upgrade will show up there in Windows Update. And on the systems that I've tried it on, the update takes about 20 minutes to complete on a Windows 7 machine. It's very quick, and it's been generally pretty accurate. But they want to make this a friction-free experience, so precisely so that they can move as many people as possible into this world. And if you start putting piracy checks and things in there, then you add friction. So they'll just make it, you know, they'll make it an update, and there it is, and you get it. And I think I tweeted something this week. Well, you can have your Windows 10, but you're still a thief and bastard of a pirate, you are.
Is this the dialogue box you're talking about? It says, this copy of Windows is not genuine. It does not pass genuine validation. To get all Windows updates and downloads reserved for genuine Windows, you must validate. But that's okay, so that's Windows Genuine Advantage. That's the thing you get.
I've gotten that message many times on PCs.
Spuriously.
On PCs, for which I paid for Windows personally.
Yeah.
So it's terrible.
Is never, I think the technology works better today than it did in the old days, but it's never flawless.
So we don't know yet what you'll see when you try to upgrade a pirated version, do we? We don't know.
No, you won't know. You won't know anything until this is actually officially released. But my prediction is that it's simply going to be an update. If you're running Windows 7, Windows 8, or Windows 8.1, or Windows 7 or 8.1, it will just update. There won't be any questions. Aside from, you know, do you approve this upgrade?
So they're not going to have a box that says, you know, are you a pirate? Yes, yes. They're not going to say, they're not going to give you some spanking or some, you know, shade, throw some shade. They're just going to upgrade you.
What would be even better is if they had if they had like an online chat window that popped up when you did it, and it was like a confessional, and you confess that you are a pirate.
Admit you're a pirate, and we'll give you a new copy of Windows. That's all we ask.
Exactly. Like the Onion, you're welcome, the Onion. If you want to go and write that piece, you know, for the launch of Windows 10, you know, about the online chat box and confessional.
Actually, Jason, I've been working on a piece exactly like that, where I think they should. basically, it's the message in this post that you pointed to earlier there, Leo, which is that, you know, if they really and truly are serious about moving people there, just make this an amnesty program for non-enterprise customers.
Yeah.
Just, you know, as part of the agreement at the end, when you click OK on the license agreement that you didn't read, part of it says that I agree that if my system was not properly licensed before, that I will, you know, abide by this license agreement going forward.
Yeah.
You know,
they probably should do something like that. Yeah. There's a precedent for this, though. That's what Apple did with iTunes Match, in effect. iTunes Match, if you pay $25, will match everything in your library. It doesn't check to see if it's pirated or not. If you, as I did, downloaded a lot of stuff from Napster in years gone by, I was young and dumb, and I needed the money. and it's in your library, it will automatically match it and replace it, if you ask, with 256 kilobit AAC licensed versions. It's kind of like that. And I expect that Apple went to the music industry and said, look, you're never going to get money from these guys. They already stole the music.
Yeah.
Would you like a portion of $25? Make everybody honest moving forward. Is that analogous to what's going on here?
Absolutely. Yeah, I think it's very, it should be very close to that. It should be, you know, somebody, I was really hoping that with the new leadership at Microsoft, that somebody would sort of throw away the old licensing gobbledygook and complication, at least for consumers and small businesses, and just replace this with something simple.
Yeah.
You know? And they still have an opportunity to do that.
Now, on Wednesday, we talked about this on Windows Weekly, but the next day, Paul Thurrott published a piece on his website, Thurrott.com, saying, sorry, Microsoft is not giving free Windows 10 to pirates. Now, the original quote came from Terry Myerson, the guy in charge of Windows 10. He had told Reuters, quote, we are upgrading all qualified PCs, genuine and non-genuine, to Windows 10. But then Microsoft issued a statement, and this is the current statement. We've always been committed to ensuring that customers have the best Windows experience possible. With Windows 10, although non-genuine PCs may be upgradable to Windows 10, the upgrade will not change the genuine state of the license.
Right.
So you're not made whole by this. You're not suddenly genuine.
No.
No. And, well, first of all, the word genuine is just such Orwellian crap speak. It makes me angry every time I hear them talk about genuine windows. Because as Harry pointed out, you can have a perfectly, you could have paid a great deal of money for a shrink wrap copy of Windows. You can install it on your computer. You can do everything you're supposed to do. And then through no fault of your own, something comes up and says, this copy of Windows is not genuine. And that's just a distortion of what the word means. But what they're trying, the lawyers got involved in this at some point, and they took over the word genuine and distorted it into this weird, weird thing. Now, Leo, the timeline of this was, there was an article earlier in the week, then Microsoft does that statement, and Paul wrote that article. And then my story from yesterday, the one that you have there on your screen, actually has some additional details on top of that.
This is typical, by the way, for when you cover Microsoft, right? There's always this shaded meaning. The statements are unclear. There might even be conflicting statements. All right, so update us, Ed Bott. What's the subsequent statement?
Well, so if you go through here, so first of all, back in January, Terry Myerson stands up and he says, we're going to give a free upgrade to Windows for everyone with Windows 7 or to every customer with Windows 7 or Windows 8.1. And then there's a footnote, and it says some editions excluded, and we have checked on this, and the editions that are excluded are Windows RT, which is dead, and Windows Enterprise editions, which are only available for volume license customers who pay for software assurance.
And you will continue to pay for that.
But everyone else, according to that January statement, any customer with Windows 7 or Windows 8.1, we'll get this. Well, then this statement comes out this week, and it starts talking about the consumer free upgrade offer. Oh, wait a minute. Mm-mm. When did consumers get dragged into this? When did we start distinguishing between consumer versions of Windows and business versions of Windows? Do we have a surprise coming later this year?
Oh, interesting.
When they go, I'm sorry, you have Windows 8.1 Pro. That doesn't have the free upgrade. That has the $10 upgrade. And, this is just more of this. They start with this message of this wonderful thing, and then the exceptions start being added all along the way. And the other thing here where nobody ever said they're going to give a free upgrade to anyone. What they said was, we will allow the upgrade to proceed on any system, genuine or non-genuine, using their language.
It's kind of, and you point out in your article, that's what it is. That's what it is now, right? That's not new.
It's not really new.
It doesn't make it genuine, and you still. But now, are they going to abandon the Windows Genuine Advantage checks?
It sure would be nice if they would, or if they.
Because this gives them a loophole. This gives them a chance. This gives them the loophole to say, "Hey." It's confusing. Here's a copy of Windows. Oh, you can't use it, though. But we did give you a free upgrade. Is that what they're going to do? Are they going to 30 days later say, oh, by the way, it's not genuine, so...
They could still break in and sue you if they felt like it.
But
I think their biggest issue is not individuals stealing Windows, though. It's PC makers who steal Windows. Right. So not the big guys, but smaller guys.
I see this all the time. Little shops who install one copy of Windows on 20 PCs.
Some companies who do that. So it's not you and me. Not that we do it, but if we did steal one copy of Windows, that's not a huge issue.
But a lot of people are victims of those little shops and they have non-genuine Windows. Yeah. They don't know it.
And in fact, Microsoft always said, we're doing you a favor by...
We're letting you continue to use it.
Or in the days when they didn't let you continue to use it, they still said, we're doing you a favor by telling you that the PC you bought has a pirated copy of Windows on it.
Yeah, it's one of those things.
All of the Windows Genuine dialog boxes say, "You may be a victim of software
victim,
counterfeiting."
Victim, right? Victim.
Yeah, you may be.
We don't blame you. You could be a victim.
So I have no problem with Microsoft continuing to enforce anti-piracy restrictions on the people who sell new PCs and don't, with a copy of Windows installed on it that they haven't paid for. But the reality is that more than 90% of the copies of Windows that are sold are coming on PCs from big companies like Dell and HP and Lenovo and
Toshiba. Will those OEMs still license Windows on those systems?
Those OEMs still license Windows. They use,
still
in fact,
pay for it.
They pay for OEM royalty licensing, where the stuff is automatically activated and you never have to see a product key. And there isn't even a sticker on your PC anymore. There's just a little hologram on the power supply or somewhere. So they're getting away from that. And so really, the addressable audience of pirates that we're talking about here now is the dying community of white box builders. Very, very few people buy white box PCs anymore.
Yeah, it doesn't make sense. A lot of times they're more expensive, or they're not as powerful, or that kind of thing. Yeah, those little shops that do that kind of thing, mostly integrators that are serving small businesses and local communities. There's just not as much of a need for it as there once was. In the same way that there aren't as many IT departments out there, and the IT departments are much smaller because people don't need their hands held to set up their machine and learn how to log in and stuff like that. Most companies are assuming that the people that they hire now can handle, can get an email or get a set of instructions and a PC and figure out, what to do. So I think that the bottom line is, a lot of times with this genuine advantage stuff in today, it ends up hurting the people that play by the rules more, right? You end up, if you have a problem with your PC and all of a sudden that genuine advantage thing causes you, a bunch of headaches, even if you bought a genuine copy, like Harry was saying earlier. And so, yeah, Microsoft really should move away from this, especially if they want to, if it appears that their goal is to get Windows on as many machines as possible and to sort of, win or a platform game, and to be a platform that's going to, continue to be, relevant and ubiquitous. Then it behooves them to, to move away from this type of thing. I don't know that it ever did them much good. I don't know that it ever helped them that much. Maybe it caused a few more people to buy licenses or that kind of thing. But it seems as if it's been something that has hurt them, more than it's helped them. It complicated the Windows experience more than it's actually, caused more people to buy licenses. Somebody will do a study on that.
I mean, it's really been in Microsoft's bones as long as there's been a Microsoft to be really paranoid and anxious about piracy.
Yeah. They're basic.
There's that letter Bill Gates wrote to the community in 1976 or whatever, where he says, I'd love to hire 20 great programmers to work on software for Microsoft, but I can't if you're going to continue to steal your software.
Yep. It does. It goes back to the very beginnings of the company. It's so true. So true.
It hasn't changed in that. But see, this is the question, though. And so to get back to the beginnings of this conversation, how do we parse now is this a new business model for Microsoft, or maybe it's not? Microsoft has muddied the waters. Your thesis, Ed, is that they said one thing and then the lawyers got a hold of it and forced them to backtrack. Is there an intention on Satya Nadella's part to bring people back into the fold and move forward, or not?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, the interview that Terry Myerson did with Reuters, the entire discussion, the key word in that was re-engage with the hundreds of millions of users in China who are using Windows XP but never paid for it and are not getting updates and don't feel comfortable thinking about getting new Microsoft services because they know they have pirated copies. So the word was re-engage. And the idea of re-engaging with pirates is actually a good one. It leads invariably to amnesty for, people who violated a business model that you're ending. And then it opens up all sorts of new opportunities for the future. But we're not going to know how it plays out for a couple months yet.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's definitely a new direction. But like, it goes back to the DNA of the company. It's so antithetical to the DNA of the company, as Harry was saying, that it's just going to be growing pains for them to get there. I don't think they can't just it's just going to be hard to throw open
clear
the door.
Communication is apparently antithetical to Microsoft's DNA. That's the what my takeaway is, and is I don't envy you guys like you, Ed, who are trying to cover this company. I know
it's job security.
I know it could be frustrating.
I know that for any announcement that they make, I'll probably get 5 or 6 columns out of it as it changes. Yeah. Morphs.
Well, and this most recent column on ZDNet is a great example of parsing the Microsoft message, and what you say in the headline, I guess, that's potential licensing mess is probably the one takeaway you can get from this. Although I think
there's actually, if you scroll down on that, scroll down till you get to the bar chart down there. You go. I think there's the story. In a nutshell, of why they need to face the reality.
The cost of Windows Vista back in 2006 was $150.
On launch day.
On launch day, $150 to consumers, $250 to business. Windows 7, $50 on launch day. And that went back up, but it started at $50 per license to consumers, $100 to business. Windows 8 is now sub $50 for business and free to Windows. Is it free?
No, it was $40, and anybody got the Pro
it's
edition.
The same for everybody. Okay.
Yeah.
So there's a downward line, and it would make sense that the next price point would be free. You can't get much lower than $40.
And that's certainly the case with every other platform, right?
But there are no other comparable platforms. You could point out OS X, but Apple sells hardware. So they don't need to make the money on the OS. Plus, there's this kind of built-in license. You can't run it.
Mobile devices. I mean,
Android.
Nobody's ever sold you updates for your mobile operating systems ever.
Nobody pays for
Android
or iOS. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. The point is that regardless of how different the models may be, once upon a time, Microsoft was involved with 90% or more of every computing device that was sold on the planet. Today, with mobile devices and tablets and servers running free operating systems, they have maybe 15 or 20% of the total market. And among consumers, at least, this is the only one where they still expect you to pay for upgrades. That's not going to happen.
And Windows, just in general, I think there are so many people out there who are basically looking for reasons not to upgrade their Windows PC in a way that's somewhat unusual. So when they heard there was no start button in Windows 8, that was a reason not to do it. Any cost is a reason not to do it. And with Windows 10, I think Microsoft, to the best of their ability, has removed every argument that might pop into somebody's head not to get it, which is a great thing to do overall, even if there are some... it's still pretty sticky for them to do, but I think they're trying to do the right thing for them and customers.
Yeah. Isn't it the case, though, that most end users never thought they paid for Windows because they never bought a copy of Windows? They just bought a new computer.
Yeah, that most people upgrade Windows by buying a new computer every few years.
So they never were aware of paying for Windows.
But, of course, a lot of people are buying new PCs a lot more rarely than they used to.
That's the other thing.
In the old days, you bought a new PC every 2 years, and Microsoft got its money.
That's a good point. That's another thing that's changed considerably. So there is an appropriate conversation about Microsoft's future business model. It's services, it's hardware, perhaps
Azure. Azure is a huge business for them. Office 365 is growing faster.
Are they going to be able to continue to charge for Office? Yeah, I guess so. It's a lot cheaper than it used to be.
Although it's gone freemium, and it might go even further in that direction over time.
When we bought that $59 WinBook, not only did they get Windows for nothing, I got a year of Office for nothing. And a tablet for nothing. I don't know what the $59 went to.
Costco.
Yeah, probably the retailer. Micro Center. Well, it's a brave new world, and it's fascinating. And you're right. You know what? It is good, Ed, because it means that there's renewed interest in what Microsoft's up to. And it is meaningful for business, for sure. And I guess consumers still buy Windows, obviously. So that it's going to matter to consumers. Does it? I guess I live in a bubble. I don't know very many Windows users. Everybody seems to be using something
else. People who live in Silicon Valley and around there, it's not the same as the rest of the world.
You go to trade shows, you don't see a lot of You see a lot of glowing Apple logos, even at the Microsoft event.
Well, go to a Starbucks in most parts of the country, especially not on the coasts, and the balance is quite different.
I see. Sorry.
And go to airports that are not, San Francisco and JFK, and you'll see much more of a balance. And even there, you are looking at affluent people who can either afford to travel or have a job where their employer pays them to travel.
A lot of people have a Windows XP desktop at
home. Or go into an office somewhere in the middle of the country where there are people with desktop PCs.
Curtis B is asking in the chat room. I think it's a reasonable comment. They said for a year. What happens a year after Windows 10 comes out? Are they going to start charging again, or is that...
I asked the same question in my post there. Do they really think that they're going to be able to charge for it? After a year? I mean, basically, anybody who is motivated to upgrade an existing PC or device running Windows 7 or Windows 8.1 is going to do it in the first year because it's free. After that first year, the only people who are going to be left are people who deliberately chose...
Right.
not to do so, or a small number of unlucky bastards who bought something that has been sitting on the shelf at their local Walmart or wherever, and is still running Windows 8.1, and they take it home, and they discover that, I have to pay.
I think once you give away something, you can't start charging.
It adds a sense of urgency.
It's all about getting everybody up to Windows 10 as quickly as possible. That's what it's really about.
It adds a sense of urgency. Yeah. Do this now.
Yeah. That's the real message of that. We're going to take a break. We got a good panel for this Windows discussion. I got to tell you, Jason Hiner from Tech Republic, CBS Interactive. We've got the Technologizer, Harry McCracken from Fast Company, Ed Bott from ZDNet. All of them have been covering Windows and Enterprise for years, and they know this subject. Let's keep talking. But first, a word from Citrix GoToMeeting. Anybody who works in business, especially in modern business where people are distributed all over the world, not just your colleagues, but your customers, know that meetings no longer are sitting around a table in a room. The way to meet, of course, from the comfort of your computer or your smartphone or your tablet with GoToMeeting. You can share the same screen. You can see each other face-to-face. They've got that incredible HD video conferencing. It's just a smarter way to meet. Even if you're all in the same space, sometimes it's easier to use GoToMeeting. With GoToMeeting, you can meet anywhere from any computer, tablet, or smartphone. No travel expense, no traffic. All you have to do is click a link. So it's really easy to start a meeting. The email goes out. They click a link. They don't have to sign up. They get the software within really about a minute at most. Usually it's faster than that. And there they are. They're in the meeting. And almost everybody now has a great webcam on their device, whether it's a tablet or a desktop. That makes you feel like you're in the same room. You see them. You can share screens. You can see each other. You can get feedback in real time. Everybody sees what you're seeing with GoToMeeting, so your team is on the same page. I love GoToMeeting, and that's why I want you to sign up for 30 days free. GoToMeeting.com. Click the try it free button. Friction-free meetings. Wouldn't that be nice? GoToMeeting.com. Try it free today. And for the next 30 days, you'll be hooked. And we thank Citrix, those good folks at Citrix, for their support. Windows Hello. That's another thing Terry Myerson talked about at WinHack. What is Windows Hello, Harry? Hello.
Windows Hello is biometric security for Windows PCs. So it's finger scanning, it's facial recognition with infrared cameras.
You might walk up to your Windows 10 PC and it would say, just like your Xbox One does now, oh, hi, Harry. Would it log you in?
I think it would log you in if it's equipped with the proper hardware, yeah.
I like
that.
And
if you've opted in.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you have to turn it on, obviously. You could still have it be that you have to type it
along. And this all, I believe... All flavors of it involve special hardware, which are not standard equipment on computers currently.
So all Microsoft's doing is saying, hey, we're going to make sure it's in the OS.
Yeah, it's baked into the system.
But OEMs, you've got to put it in there, whether it's, you could even do iris or fingerprint scan.
Which is a great idea, given that right now you're sort of, for anything you do that requires security on your computer, you're dependent on the company behind particular service.
Yeah. And it could be used for two-factor, too, right? I mean, you could...
So there's a second part to this.
Passport.
Which is interesting, which is Passport and Microsoft's continuing quest to reuse every product name they've ever used.
Passport was their single sign-on solution, which I was really high on, but it never took off.
And it was, and then it became Windows Live ID, and then it became the Microsoft account that you have. But so the Passport component of it is really interesting because you'll have a, so if you have a Windows 10 device, it can be enrolled essentially with your biometric information, so that the cryptographic hardware component at the heart of your device, the TPM. There's a virtual layer on top of that that's, you know, going to securely store this. But it's basically going to say this device and your biometric information together will allow you to sign into online services. And online.
Oh, so this is not just for logging onto Windows. This is getting into websites.
Windows Hello logs you onto your PC.
Yeah.
The Passport thing provides a secure form of authentication, and it uses the FIDO standard, interoperates with the FIDO standard, so it doesn't have to be, nobody has to do anything with Microsoft servers or anything like that. So the idea is you could have a picture of my face and try and use it to sign in as me somewhere, but that's not going to work because you don't have my device. And if you have my device, but you don't have my biometric information, you can't. It's the combination of those two.
I love this.
That is essential. And so what they're trying to do is finally make two-factor authentication something that mere mortals can use.
Will they do it?
Good luck.
Because you got to get OEMs to put expensive hardware into the computers.
The hardware's already there.
It is.
It's getting cheaper. That's getting so much cheaper, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if you're seeing, fingerprint readers in Samsung and Apple phones, it can't be too expensive.
And it's been like a chicken and the egg situation. You need the hardware.
You need the software.
You need the software. You need consumers to want to use it.
Will we see, if it's face recognition, well, Microsoft said you can't just use the camera you've got. It has to have infrared sensing. It's kind of more like the Xbox One camera, the Kinect.
It's the same technology that they've been using with Kinect.
Yeah.
For a long time. So there are liveness tests with it,
right.
And there's also tests
hold up a picture of Ed Bott and it would look like you, but it has to test to see whether your infrared is heated.
I mean, make no mistake, we need two-factor authentication. I mean, we need it in the worst way. You know, so many of the breaches and things that are happening is, you know, poor security in so many ways. But passwords still are, you know, the weakest link. And, we need two-factor. And so this is anything that pushes it forward is a good thing. So I think you have to look at this as you know, something that's needed. And the question is, how well it's implemented? Can it move the needle? Can it get a lot more people on it more quickly? And like we've talked about, it's the largest platform out there, even though it is only now, as Ed was saying, 15% of all computing devices, where it used to be closer to 90, it's still, you know, one of the biggest chunks. And so if it can move this forward in a meaningful way, you know, it makes the world more secure.
So April 5th, 2006, 9 years ago, Ed Bott wrote an article, "Why Does Microsoft Passport Suck?" Good news. You can recycle that article, Ed. Who'd have thunk it?
True.
Isn't that funny? Yeah. That's the other passport. That's the single sign-on. And it was a disappointment because it could have been things.
Yeah.
So FIDO, for some reason, I get the sense Google's, they're not behind it, but they're involved with it, right?
Oh, they're a big part of it.
Okay. Yeah. So that's good news because it needs to be a standard that everybody gets behind, right?
And that's also, and Visa and MasterCard and almost all the banks are involved with FIDO. And so this is something where if you can put it on Windows devices and you've already got Samsung and Apple devices that have Touch ID, you have they can add this same basic type of authentication. And you can, and if you have people doing this, there are no more passwords anymore, at least for those transactions. There's no password being stored on a server that can be stolen by some guy in the Ukraine, and there's no password that you are typing into your laptop when you're sitting in a coffee shop that can be stolen by a guy who's hacked into the Wi-Fi access point. This is all really well-tested cryptographic technology. There's no reason why this can't work and work well and sooner than anyone expects.
It's going to look a lot like Touch ID does right now with the Apple Pay, right? So, in fact, this is from the FIDO Alliance site. The passwordless experience would be you want to make a transaction. You've authenticated to your hardware, for instance, with a Touch ID on an iOS device. Then the success, and it's done. And then the two-factor adds some sort of additional dongle or some other device. I have
no. It's simply where you've gone through a process of enrolling that device.
Okay.
If you have an iPhone or a Windows phone or whatever, it has a cryptographic.
I see.
Device once on it.
Right. Got it. So authentication is really one of the central issues in computing. It's for payments, but it's also just for logging into a website. We didn't have passwords 100 years ago, except maybe to get into a speakeasy, swordfish. but before that, I mean, really, nobody had passwords. So this is only a recent problem created by the web. And I would love to see it solved.
That's amazing how long the hardware has existed. I mean, when did the first PCs with fingerprint scanners come out? Like 15 years ago, maybe longer. Right. And it never really has caught on, but it does feel good now.
So the second factor could just be your phone. I mean, maybe you enter a PIN. A PIN plus the phone would be a two-factor.
Well, that'd actually be a three-factor.
Wow.
If you have biometric, it's multi-factor authentication. So, right. So basically imagine... the nightmare scenario for a Hollywood star who has their picture is everywhere and their password gets stolen. But if the only way into their shared their secrets they don't want to share is with a device that has been enrolled to them, then the fact that you've stolen their secret and the fact that you can place a picture of them up in front of the camera, you've got to have their device too. And at that point, you've got multi-factor authentication, which that works pretty well.
Good news. This would be great. Now, our friend Steve Gibson has created this thing called Squirrel, which he's really big on, which eliminates passwords logging into websites. But it's similar. In fact, in some ways, it's maybe more elegant than FIDO. But the fact that you've got all these companies back and up FIDO seems to me this is, even if there's a better solution out there, this seems like this is going to go. And not a moment too soon, I might add.
Yep.
Yeah. I have a YubiKey that is FIDO 2 compliant. I'm not sure what that means or how I use it, but it's one of those USB devices you plug in there. And I guess that would be a form of authenticating.
The YubiKey works with LastPass.
Yes, that's right.
One of the biggest. Yes. I've used that before, and so basically, you're traveling somewhere, and you go to a hotspot in some dodgy place, and you want to have LastPass authenticate you in somewhere. If someone's stolen your LastPass password, they can't get into your store of extremely valuable passwords unless they have that USB key.
Right.
And then when you take that USB key away, whatever you entered on that PC is no longer useful.
So the last probably three Twit episodes have been almost entirely devoted to the Apple Watch. Thank God we have something else to talk about. And there's somebody in the chat room saying, where's the Apple Watch news?
I think this is refreshing.
Thank you,
it's a refreshing change.
Yes.
Look, we just go where the news leads us, you know? We'll be talking about the Apple Watch in a few weeks. I'm sure we're not done with that. This was a story, and I want some clarification on this, Ed Bott, because I could swear that two or three months ago, On Windows Weekly, we said Microsoft is going to is Project Spartan is going to replace Internet Explorer, and it's going to have a new name. But for some reason this week, every blog in the world published this. Here's Tom Warren on The Verge. Microsoft is killing off the Internet Explorer brand. Didn't we know this?
Yes.
What's new?
Nothing.
Okay, just checking.
And they're not really killing it off, if killing it off means not distributing IE anymore. Which
they're going to still put it on Windows.
Which they're going to continue to do.
Yeah, compatibility.
It's Microsoft, so it can never be a clean transition.
So there's really no, this is meaningless story.
I think they said it in a clearer fashion that they were going to do it. They said they were thinking about it before. I think when they first showed Spartan, they did not say, and this thing will definitely not be called IE.
I see.
And now they've said that Spartan will not be called IE, although they're not saying what Spartan will be called.
Right. They haven't come up with a name yet. And Spartan kind of is a little different than IE, but it started with the same engine. They forked the engine. The fork will eliminate bugs or I don't know. It's, you know what?
But there's two problems here. One is add-ons.
Yeah.
If you have a browser that runs add-ons, it becomes a vector for malware and things that cause pop-ups and
chiefly
stuff.
Chiefly Adobe Reader and Flash.
Anything with the ASK brand name.
Yeah.
On it. There's that. But the bigger part of the problems with web compatibility these days are websites that are just written and tested because they assume that the entire world runs on Chrome. And so you show up with another browser, whatever it is, even if it's Opera, which is running on a rendering engine that's very similar to Chrome. It's
WebKit,
Blink.
Right?
Yeah. It's actually, they're running, Opera these days is running on Blink.
Really? Which is Google's fork of WebKit.
Right, and yet I've run the latest version of Opera, and I've gone to websites that fail because the developers. I mean, basically, Chrome is now the new Internet Explorer.
Yeah,
Chrome market share is that high? Firefox is not in the game. Opera's not in the game. It's Chrome.
Well, in terms of the thing that people write websites to work with.
Ah, interesting.
Yeah,
people who write websites. They use Chrome.
Right.
It's sort of like Windows. There are, I think, large parts of the world where the market share breakdown is different. I also feel, by the way, that nobody really knows for sure what the market shares are of web browsers. Because if you look at the three or four biggest companies that track this, they're radically different, and they have different people in first place.
Right.
And with some of them, Firefox looks dead. And in some of them, Firefox still looks like it's doing pretty well.
Well, here's the good news. We have choice, and there's a standard that means websites look alike no matter where you go or what you use, right?
There are so many standards. That's the great thing about standards. There's so many of them.
We're involved in a web redesign right now, and it's really fascinating to watch. But there are what's nice for web developers, there are now tools that will make it so, you just put some code in and it automatically checks the browser and then
the devil's in the details.
It's hard to do.
Sometimes when I put together websites, I've suddenly noticed they don't really work in IE hardly at all because I forgot to check.
Yep.
And they may not work well in Spartan if I forget to check.
Is Spartan going to be more standards compliant? What does that even mean?
Well, for the last God knows how many years, with every new version of IE, Microsoft always says the big news is it's standards compliant.
Right.
And we're not going to assume the world is going to tweak everything to work in IE anymore. But that mantra has been going on for 7 or 8 years or more. And unless they actually adopt WebKit or Blink, there will be some technical challenges.
So the thing about web standards is, first of all, there's two standards organizations. There's W3C.
IEEE. Are they responsible?
And what WG, I think, or somebody in the chat room will correct us on this. But there's basically two standards organizations. But the reality is that web technology is moving so quickly that basically by the time a standard is declared, it was already adopted 12 or 18 months earlier. And so the de facto thing now is, does it run on Chrome? Have you tested it on other things? Put it into production. And if people complain about it, we'll fix it if it's a big enough market for our company to pay attention to this group of people who are complaining about it. So that, I mean, that's the reality. There, the standards are these days are de facto, not actual declared standards anymore.
I'm sorry, I got distracted. Somebody sent us a link to windows93.net. Have you seen this website?
I have. I love it.
Thank you, chat room, for ruining the rest of my day. And let's see, here's, what is this? Credits. So here's who wrote it. And then when you close the window, it kind of, woo. Warning, a satanic kitten orgy is happening on Skype right now. We're working hard restoring the normality. Stay tuned. Okay. Acid Box 93. I don't know what. Oh, this is like Zombo.com, right? This is the gift that just keeps on giving. Windows93.net. Can I? What happens if I pick shut down? Oh, it shuts down. And reboot. Very true to life.
It did restart quickly, though.
That was much faster than normal. Let me try one more time if I can shut this down. See, now it's rebooting again. I like the startup sound.
Oh, man.
Well, I'll have to play. I'll play with this more later. Thank you, whoever mentioned this in the chat room.
But Leo, the problem with Spartan is that we're almost into April now.
Yeah.
Right. And Windows 10 is going to ship this summer.
Soon.
So let's just pick midsummer.
Yeah.
Let's just say, sometime in early August would be a logical time for them to. Do the whatever the 2015 equivalent of releasing to manufacturing is. No one outside of Microsoft has tested this new browser yet. And we are May, June, July. We are less than 4 months away from.
That's not a good sign, is it?
That seems weird to me.
Yeah, it doesn't come in the Windows 10 beta, which, by the way, an update to that came out this week.
Yeah, it's not. It's not in the latest.
It's not in there.
The latest update. Nope.
So you've got millions of people trying, testing, banging on Windows 10, but not Spartan. That's not there. They don't even have a name yet, that we know of. Here's another interesting story. John Russell at TechCrunch points out that at the end of the Microsoft announcement, they mentioned they're testing Windows 10 with power users of Xiaomi's Mi 4. Android smartphone? Windows 10 phone runs on Android? What's the story here?
Well, so you know how the HTC One M8.
You can get Windows phone on it. It's gorgeous. Yeah.
Well, and they have an Android version.
Yeah.
And they have a Windows version.
Right.
And they're absolutely identical hardware.
Oh.
Except for the so what they're doing apparently is reflashing the ROM.
And it works.
So that then you can install Windows Phone on top of it.
Because
it's just in the same way that you can take the PC that you buy from your white box builder,
mm-hmm.
and you can either put Linux on it or you can put Windows on it. Because
that'd be an interesting move from Microsoft to offer ROMs for smartphones, for Windows 10 for Android devices. That'd be a very interesting. I'd be tempted. What are they thinking of doing that, you think?
God only knows.
They have to be careful because they don't want to give anybody the impression that Windows Phone is not a viable platform all by itself. Although I think everybody's already got that impression. They are. So I do like the strategy that Microsoft has, and I like it as a company that wants to do software. We want to do our own apps, and the question about should we do a Windows Phone app? That's a tough one because while I want to support our Windows users and our Windows Weekly viewers, we know how small a market Windows Phone is. But Microsoft solves that conundrum a little bit by offering this universal platform where we could develop for Windows desktop?
Well, not
Windows.
Really. Well,
no? We could make one app that's Metro, that's Xbox. You know, the thing that makes it compelling is if it would run on the Xbox, which apparently it would. Right?
Well, for an app like yours, it actually does make sense.
Because it's not complicated. I'm not writing Excel here.
Yeah. Well, it's not complicated, and it's also immediate consumption
right.
platform or product
right.
that works on a device that's this big or one that's, a 50-inch
TV. We've been kept off of Xbox One because of the onerous process of making an Xbox app. It's very costly.
Yeah, so for a media app like yours, the Universal app does make sense. But now imagine, the other banking
yes,
app.
Yes, of course.
For example. Right.
Well, that's important. So sure. Chase just pulled its app from Windows Phone. The banks
are and so did B of A.
So did B of A. Chase has actually taken the app away.
Based on lack of interest or what was the
rationale? I don't know. It's too much trouble to keep it up to date. And there's not enough people using it. Yeah, I guess it would be. If you're doing a banking app, it's not like you can just say, okay, well, just use the old one.
Right.
You have to at some point say, you know, we can't let you continue to use the old one. It's not secure anymore or whatever.
Yeah, I think the argument was that at some point, they decided they were no longer going to support it. It wasn't economically viable for them. The market wasn't big enough. And they said at some point it's going to break. So rather than wait until we do an update to our back end that causes it to break, and then we have to go, oops, to our however many thousands or tens of thousands of Windows Phone users there are, we have to say, sorry, we broke it and we're not going to fix it. They said, we're just going to pull it from the store. And I think they gave a month's notice or something. But they said, rather than have this break unexpectedly, we're going to have it break expectedly.
They told us last month that they were pulling it, but as of yesterday, it stopped working.
Yeah.
So, you know, even...
And they did that knowing that this universal Windows development platform is imminent, which is not a great...
As of 3/22/2015, we're no longer supporting the Chase mobile app for Windows Phone. To continue to access your Chase accounts on your Windows Phone after 3/22, that's today... please visit chase.com in the browser.
It's kind of like the 1990s, where if you were a Mac user, one by one, a bunch of really important things stopped being developed for your Mac because the people who were responsible for them had no faith in the continued viability of your platform.
It's sad in the same way, too, because you know what? Windows Phone is great.
There's another issue about the Universal App story that doesn't work, which is that all of those PCs will fully support web apps, which is where... So they'll just say, if you're using a PC, why should we build a universal app that will only run on Windows 10 when we can just say, go open your browser and go to chase.com and sign in and we'll send you your two-factor code and you can do anything you want to on the web. That becomes... And then with an iPhone or with the Android platform, you've got enough tens or hundreds of millions of users that you can build an app that has additional capabilities, like you can take a picture of a check and deposit it and such. But those are the sort of unique capabilities that you get with a mobile app that you don't need on a PC.
I have to say that even the Android apps for some banks are pretty much just thinly veiled skins to browser interactions. It's pretty obvious, right?
Yeah,
I mean, so why not just do a browser-based app? Especially if you can make it secure, make it work. Why not? What's the disadvantage? All right, so I know I was all excited about the Universals thing, but you've poured water on that one.
It's what I do, Leo.
Sling TV. One more Microsoft story, then we'll move on. Sling TV comes to Xbox One. I'm actually, this is really more a story of Sling TV, which I think is growing in power and is really the first time we've seen a lot of traditional cable channels go over the top, especially ESPN. I think Sling TV, you know, this is kind of under the shadow of Apple apparently making moves, we think, this fall to do this.
And Sony has PlayStation View as of last week.
Oh, tell me about that. I haven't seen that.
Well, it's the closest thing that Sling TV has to an arch rival as of right now. Right now it's only on PlayStations and only in, I think, New York, Chicago, and Philadelphia. But it's another over-the-top service. It has 85 channels. It has richer functionality than Sling TV because it has a cloud-based DVR.
Oh, interesting.
And catch-up and on-demand. And it's coming to the iPad. I think Sony is saying it will come to other devices. And I wrote about it and I said it's the closest thing so far to cable TV for the internet because it's really comparable. And even the pricing is
doesn't
not
it come down
different.
To the channels, not functionality? Is it the same channels?
It's a lot of them. It's not every single one. They don't have ESPN, but they do have a deal with NBC. And
yeah, see, CBS, NBC's doing the same thing to Apple. Yeah. Apple, they're saying to Apple, no, we're not going to go along for the ride. Right. We'll have our own app.
Nobody has all the channels you want yet, but PlayStation View does have more channels than Sling does have right now.
How much is it?
It starts at $50 and it goes up to like 70.
A month?
Yes. You're not going to get this and cable. If you're cheap, you're not going to get this. It really is sort of a form of pay TV that happens to come across the internet to your PlayStation. But a well-done one, as far as I can see.
I'll have to try it. Sling TV is $20 a month. You get ESPN 1 and 2. You get AMC, and when Mad Men returns in a month, that's going to be a big deal.
And there's some add-on packs. The thing that's nice about Sling is there are $5 add-on packs, and they're by theme. So if you like sports, you can pay an extra $5. The PlayStation View pricing is more similar to tiers on cable, where the more you pay, the more channels you get, but it's sort of a random assortment of extra channels.
So for $20, you get these basic ones, IFC, SP1 and 2, CNN, Disney, ABC Family. Then you can add Sports Extra, which gives you ESPNU, ESPN News, a lot of sport, Universal Sports. There's a Kids Extra. There's a Hollywood
you get
Extra.
All the packs. There's five of them.
Each is $5 a month.
Bucks.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's like 40. So it is kind of comparable because it's like
by the
45
time you
bucks
add
if you got all of them.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're at $45 by the time. So
you don't
I
need
had,
all of them.
Yeah, but I'm not sure I'd want all of them.
Yeah.
So what was interesting with Sling TV was I actually tweet-stormed my setup experience with Sling TV on the Xbox One this week. It was not a good experience. They had some real problems. I was really excited because it was the first day that it was available, and I have an Xbox One in the living room, and I thought, well, I got to see what this is like. And they're giving every Xbox One owner one free month with the basic service, so you could try it out there. Really not a good sign-up experience. So I talked to the folks from Sling TV, and they acknowledged they had some problems with it. They now appear to have fixed all those setup processes. And so I was able to use it last night. And so while it has some really appealing things to it, one of the things I did, I turned on one of the NCAA games last night, and said, oh, this is great. And then I discovered, first of all, you can't, pause.
Oh,
you can't,
it's like live TV.
Yeah, it is exactly like live TV. Apparently, some of their channels will offer up to 3 days of back content that you can watch. But even there, it's up to the content provider whether they're going to allow you to skip commercials or not, whether the fast forward and rewind buttons will work. When it worked for me last night, the picture quality was just superb. It was really, really, really good. And then all of a sudden, at a very crucial part of the game, it just started freezing up. And it would go for 10 seconds, and then there'd be some guy standing there like this with the basketball leaving his hand. And then it would start up again, and I don't know what happened. I had to see the scoreboard to see what happened.
I presume you have very good internet. I mean, the Skype's looking good.
Yeah, this was a wired full bandwidth 50 megabit connection. So there wasn't anything there. I think it's just, we're still in, even though cord cutting is finally starting to happen and starting to really hurt cable and satellite providers, we're still early in the technology days.
It's not hurting them enough.
It's going to be messy. for a long time. And there's an entire generation of people who are just going to say, you know what, screw this. I'll watch whatever's on my computer.
That's what I think.
Yep.
That's what I think.
I see that already, too. Exactly that.
We want to watch. We want an analog to our existing system of live TV cum cable. They don't care. If it's on YouTube, it's good enough.
There's so many channels. You know, I mean, the things have come out again and again that most people watch 5 to 10 channels, right? And for years, we've been saying, like, okay, if they could offer them a la carte, you know, probably they would keep more customers. And eventually people have kind of gotten hung up. I mean, most of the people, almost everyone I know under 30 does not have a cable subscription.
All you really care about is high-speed internet, period. And you'll figure it out.
Even more people in their 30s and 40s I see, too, that are just, you know, they're tired of it and they don't watch enough of it. They don't really have time or whatever. And so they'll cut. And there's things that they want that they wish they could have and they probably would pay for in a la carte. They'd pay $5 a month or whatever for some of their favorite channels. But, you know, it's one of those things that it is going to be messy and it is ugly. And that's why some of these solutions, there's a lot of tension in, you know, with these solutions. But at least it's finally happening. At least it's finally there's going to be some options. This year seems like 2015 seems like it's has the potential to be a little bit of a watershed year in kind of cord cutting.
It feels like there's cracks. Yeah. But I want to take a break and come back because I want to talk about Ben Thompson of Stratechery's take on this. He says, actually, this was from an article he wrote some time ago. Cable TV is socialism that works. Subscribers pay equally for everything and watch only what they want to the benefit of everyone. Any grand vision Apple or any other tech company has for television is likely to sustain the current model, not disrupt it directly. All right, think about that and we'll talk about what that means and whether you agree in a moment. But first, we have a word from Harry. Well, Harry's. Do you own Harry's?
I enthusiastically endorse anything with Harry in the name, but I do not own it.
You are going to love Harry's. If you haven't tried Harry's yet, please. Harry's is fixing a problem we all have, or most of us do, paying too much for overpriced razor blades. First of all, shaving's bad enough. I mean, really, let's face it, guys. And gals, too, I guess. It's just not fun to get up every morning and shave. Razors are expensive. They run about $4 a blade. If you shave every day, you're spending hundreds of dollars a year on just razor blades. And you got to, they're locked up. They're worth so much, they're locked up in a cabinet at the drugstore. Harry's has decided they want to make this better. They want to make the shaving experience, hey, it's not going to be fun, but it's going to be better. Actually, you know what? It might even be fun. Harry's sells high-quality razor blades at about half the price of those big brand names because, and I love this, when Harry's was, this is Silicon Valley mentality. When Harry's was started a couple of years ago, they said, where are the best razor blades come from? Well, there are only two factories. They are both in Germany. So they bought one. They said, yeah, well, okay, good. We'll take it. We'll take a factory, please. So now they control the production of this factory. They engineer for performance, for sharpness, and they ship them free to your front door. And because they sell direct to you, they can sell them for about a half the cost of the blade you buy in the drugstore. That is nice. Factory direct because they own the factory. By the way, if you're going to go to harrys.com, take a look at the kits because that's how you get started. You need the Harry's handle. Now, here's where they could really take you for a ride, but they don't. Take a look at the Truman. This is the base model. You get three blades, a gorgeous handle, and a variety of colors. You get either their foam or their cream. You know what? They both have their partisans. I like the cream that comes in a tube, but some people say, no, I prefer a gel, so they have the choice. And for $15, you get all of that, plus a travel holder, which I really like. Three blades, the handle, the gel or the cream, and for $15, but I'm going to make it even more affordable. If you want a nice metal handle, you can go out and get the Winston, which is the next one up. That's $25. You can even get it engraved with your name. Harry gives me a clean, close, comfortable shave, and I have to say it does make shaving a lot more pleasurable, and I love the cream, but they even have a new moisturizer, which you'll like. And once you buy the kit, the starter kit, you're going to get those blades. You can say every month, every other month, as needed, automatically refilled. So here's the deal. You got to try it. The kit is very affordable because we're going to give you $5 off at harrys.com. Your first purchase, use the offer code TWIT and the number 5, TWIT 5, HARRYS.com. That makes it $10 to try this. Get the Truman. You will love it. I get tweets all the time from people who go crazy because they just love Harry's. You will love it too, Harry. Be the smartest man in the bathroom. Harrys.com. Make sure you use the offer code TWIT5 to get $5 off at checkout. So I thought this was very interesting. I think what Ben Thompson is saying about cord cutting is you've got a really entrenched industry. Don't expect to save money. Don't even expect to change the structure of television if that's your plan, because it's these incumbents are so entrenched and they have so much power. They're not, Apple can't come to them and say, let's change this all this fall. Apple's been trying to negotiate these things for years with no success.
Yeah.
Why all of a sudden are we saying it's going to happen in the fall? I'm not convinced.
Well, the owners have loosened up a bit. That's why Sling TV exists. That's why the PlayStation stuff exists.
Well, the content companies have loosened up, right? But I guess maybe they're less afraid of the cable companies. Is that why?
HBO finally is biting the bullet and doing this. So something is happening with or without Apple. But presumably Apple is going to do it as good or better a job of anybody of pushing forward.
Somebody in the chat room said, and I'm curious if you dispute this. It doesn't matter because you're going to end up paying just as much. You're not going to save money on a cord cutter scenario. You may even end up paying more.
Well, you may have a little bit more flex to choose what you want. And the nice thing about Sling TV is you do it, it's a little bit cheaper, and you'll probably end up not subscribing to 75 channels that you never watch. You'll have a smaller number of channels which you might watch.
Yeah, because then you only buy the stuff, as you said, 5 channels, you only buy the stuff that you care about.
And yep. I would hope that Comcast and DirecTV and everybody would be forced to respond to that in some shape or form.
Remember that the Comcast margin on internet, according to Ben, is 97%.
Wow.
It is a very profitable business. So all of us have been saying, oh, man, boy, Comcast is never going to let go of this premium TV business. Wait a minute. As long as they get the price high enough, 97% margin, they're going to be perfectly happy to be your internet service provider.
Yeah.
I didn't realize it was that high, but of course it is. With cable TV, they're paying $16 a month for ESPN for each and every subscriber. The internet costs them nothing.
I'm a little skeptical about that number. They have fairly substantial capital costs.
Yeah, but once you do it, you just kind of, you know, I mean, I don't think the maintenance is huge on this stuff.
Yeah, well, if you want to be able to deliver faster speeds to people, then you've got to dig up roads and put in fiber.
This is a good article MIT Technology Review referred to. David Talbot wrote this in 2013, referred to by Ben Thompson and Stratechery, in which one of the things they say is that labor is actually the big cost. About 80% of the cost is the labor of digging up the street, not the fiber itself.
Sure, sure. I mean, and paying for permits is not
permits.
Cheap either,
but, yeah, but once you get the fiber laid, you're just rolling in dough.
Well, they're going to have a reinvestment. They're going to have to do, I mean, they're due for having to do some reinvestment. You know, a lot of the stuff that's there is stuff that they've had for years.
Right.
And Google Fiber is putting pressure on them and others to, you know, to do some big upgrades so that they can keep up. And I think we've written about this on Tech Republic repeatedly. Google Fiber is, I think, is for real, and I think that they see it as a massive opportunity.
They see it as a business, not as a proof of concept?
I think they see it as a business. I do think long-term it is a business for Google. They know the internet. They know that everything they do on the internet contributes to their bottom line, and they know that the cable companies are the lead, that run this now. The companies that run this now are, you know, the least liked companies in America, like as an industry. They rank below like lawyers and journalists. And so
for a while, the cable guy was outpacing heart attacks as the least desirable thing in America. I'm not making that up.
Yes.
You'd rather have a heart attack than see the cable guy.
Yeah. So it's like
your heart attack will be here between 4 and 8 p.m.
It's more predictable. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, exactly. It's more predictable. So, I mean, the thing is, Google sees it's a real opportunity. And because of that, it's putting real pressure
Is it profitable, Google Fiber?
Oh, yeah.
It is. Yeah. $70 a month.
Yes, it's profitable Gigabit. Because they're going in, especially right now, because they're going in and they're buying a lot of dark fiber, right? They're buying fiber that's been abandoned or fiber that was laid and nobody used.
There's a lot of that.
There's plenty. And so, and they're, municipalities have laid, like in Provo, they went in. Provo was going to put fiber to the home in every place, right? And it kind of, the whole project kind of fell apart. Google swooped in, bought all that fiber and, at a cut rate, right? And made it active and turned that on and is still turning it on.
Let me ask you about, you're near Chattanooga, right?
Yes, not far away. So, yes, they have fiber there too.
They spent, they had federal funds. They spent $110 million. Chattanooga municipality owns the fiber.
Yes.
Do they, and then they charge a lot for access to its gigabit.
Yeah.
Is it open to other providers or are they the only provider on top of it?
I'm not sure about that, Leo. I mean, I think at this point, I don't think it is open to other providers.
It's just
them.
So you're going to see that is not what we want. Which is
the new monopoly.
The new monopoly.
Same as the old monopoly.
Yeah, well, that's not what we want.
Right, exactly. We need competition. There's no doubt. I mean, the whole economic system that we live under in the United States is based on competition. And when you don't have real competition, then
that's
things,
what we got.
Things have problems. That's what we've got in the internet realm. And, I do tip my hat. Google does all kinds of crazy, weird things. But I do tip my hat to them for what they're doing in fiber. I think they, have made the right steps. They're not doing everything right. We've written about that too. And in some of these things, they talk a big game about helping out little guys and giving, free internet. Because they'll give you free internet for in those Google Fiber areas. You get a much more cut rate, speed. But they talk a big game about that, about rolling it out for free. But in order to do it for free, there are weird obstacles. Like you have to prepay for like your some of your equipment and things like that. And then it becomes cost prohibitive to the kind of people who could really benefit, from this kind of thing. And so, they've got plenty of kinks to iron out. But in general, I think they're on the right track, and it is going to put pressure on the Comcast of the world to do kind of upgrades. To back to what I was getting at was Ed's point was, they're going to have to invest more in their networks to keep up with Google Fiber, and that's ultimately a good thing. And that 97% profit margin is going to go down, but it's still going to be highly profitable.
Is this a good time to launch an over-the-top service or a bad time? Over the top means not over the television, but
there's
over
some cool
the internet.
Ones out there. I wrote about Shout Factory TV, which is all kind of old, quirky stuff. There's Acorn TV, which is all British stuff.
So instead of it seems to me you'd be nuts to start a new cable channel today. It's, by the way, very expensive, as we found out at Tech
TV.
Well,
a lot of the little guys are only being carried along because they're being carried along by that big price you pay for the stuff you do want.
That's that socialism at work, yeah. The guy who started Discovery has gone off to create something called Curiosity Stream, curiositystream.com. And it is the same thing. It's streaming, kind of Discovery style programming. The problem is, you're going to be a little guy unless you either hit a niche. This might be a niche. There are people who sit and watch the History Channel all day. Or you get the big show. You pull a Netflix and you get House of Cards or.
Netflix is paying $5 billion a year.
It's a lot of money.
It will be for original content.
Yeah, and that's tough because if you don't get a hit, you've really thrown that money away. Hollywood is a hit-based economy. A lot of these companies only make it because they have 1 in 10, massive successes.
And you're not going to pay $8 a month to like 15 different services.
Right. You need to be the one or the two.
Or you need to have a model that doesn't involve that. Like Shout Factory TV is actually ad-supported.
Oh, that's interesting. So it's free?
Yes.
Yeah.
Hey, well,
Two things about Google Fiber. Uh-huh. Number one, there was a story a couple weeks ago where They found some correspondence from Google to some of the municipal governments that they were of the cities that they were planning to come into, and the communications from Google basically said, you know, if you make this easy, if you remove obstacles from the permitting process and make it easy for us to get in here, we'll move into your community. Anything else, we're not interested.
Right.
We'll just leave. We'll go somewhere else. And so they're basically cherry picking
right.
places where, and it's economically rational for them to do it. If I were running the business, I would do it exactly the same way. But they are cherry picking the places where they can run the business exactly the way they want to. A second thing that I saw that seemed to be a dot that deserves to be connected here was the thing about AT&T and their UVerse service, where, remember, they were offering, if you pay us $10 more, we won't sell your personal information to advertisers, right? You remember this?
Yeah.
So while I genuinely admire what Google is doing to bring high-speed internet to large parts of the country, it is also profoundly in their economic interest. Right now, they only get information about you when you're visiting a site and you are signed into Google and that site has Google services like AdSense or Google Analytics.
I want Google to know more about me.
When they own the fiber, you won't have a choice of whether they know more about you.
They'll know everything.
They're going to get literally every single packet that comes from your home through Google Fiber, they will know about. And so that's, you know, and if you're happy with that, that's great. But it's something that I think we should be
aware of.
Aware of and talking about.
Yeah. I know it doesn't really bother me. I want Google now to be more useful. The more it knows about me, the happier I am, to be honest. What do I care? I want ads that I'm interested in. I don't want ads I'm not interested in.
The city thing is interesting though too. In terms of, I think Google is absolutely going into the cities that are making it easy for them, and they're going in there first. And I think their thing is, we'll go in there first, and then you'll be jealous once, you know, the citizens of that neighboring city that you're really competitive with, now all of a sudden their small businesses and their entrepreneurs and their, you know, citizens are getting better internet, and then they're asking you, like, hey, why don't we have it? You know, why does Nashville have it in Memphis? And here in Memphis, we don't have it. And then that will put pressure. I think that's their that's their game that they're
playing. They went into Nashville because they had a very low level of regulatory involvement. They made it easy. They greased it, as Ed was saying.
Yep.
But you said
again,
something.
We have a lot on this. You can read a bunch on this on Tech Republic. We've written about it. Connor Forrest has done some really good research, including the cities that are most likely to get Google Fiber next that have sort of the factors that play in their favor. Mm-hmm.
I would throw the whole city council of Petaluma out of office and elect robots if we could get Google Fiber. Rubber stamping Google bots. Why should I worry, Ed, about Google knowing every TV bit I watch and every internet bit I watch?
I don't think anyone should know, should be able to collect and preserve every bit of information that you have. If you want to opt into that, if you think it's great, fine. But I don't want anyone collecting and collating a database of information.
Well, I'm curious. I'm willing to get you to talk me out of this. But what is the harm you're worried about?
We've been through this before, and the harm is when, first of all, they sell that information to someone else who makes a decision about you, an insurance company,
right?
Or a health insurance company decides to, you know, deny you coverage. Because of something that they found in your internet history, or an employer decides that they're not going to hire you because there's something in a database about you. But the real problem is that these random collections of data about us can create an impression that is incorrect. That's the worst part.
Right.
I want control over it.
But if you take a picture of yourself eating donuts and put it on Facebook, you could be doing the same damage. At least I get something for my Google.
Yes,
for
if I go and research, if a friend of mine develops esophageal cancer, and I go and start doing some searches to learn more about their disease,
right,
And an insurance company decides that I'm a poor risk because they think that historically 90% of people who research esophageal cancer are doing so because a member of their family has been diagnosed with this, and so therefore we're going to deny them coverage. Now, at the moment, we have laws in this country that make it impossible for them to deny that kind of coverage. But, you know, who knows in the future? Let's say that I happen to like to follow the horse races, and my employer, I apply for a job, and the employer finds this in my internet history, which is available from Google, and they decide, your profile matches with people who are unreliable employees, so we're not going to hire you. The trouble is, it creates an impression of you that is based on algorithms and averages and not on who you really are.
Yeah.
And I don't like that.
I mean, is this something to worry about more today than it was with some other ISP 10 years ago or with AOL 20 years ago?
Google's
smarter at this stuff.
Look how much storage is available today. The trouble is that 10 or 15 or 20 years ago, nobody could afford to store data for more than a few days. Now, the web analytics companies that you've never heard of are collecting massive amounts of information, inconceivable amounts of information. And I know that word doesn't mean... They're just unfathomable amounts of information, and they're collecting it because they can. And then at some point, the technology for analyzing it will catch up, and then when that happens, it's too late. And so I use a service, for example, that when I go to Google, it anonymizes my searches and doesn't let them know who I am, so that my history is blurred.
That's your Google Now is no longer very useful, see, because Google knows what I've searched for, so they give me information in my Google Now that's useful.
And if you want to opt into that, that's
awesome.
I have. Awesome.
I've opted into it full time.
That's great. That's great.
We'll see.
I haven't.
I like it.
And I don't want to live in a world where I don't have
But you do have the choice.
I have to take great pains to avoid having my information go into Google's mighty databases.
Right.
Yeah, I thought the point that Ed mentioned that, maybe is most important is we don't even have the ability to analyze it very well, though Google can better than most. But there will be, data analysis is getting better and better. It hasn't caught up, but it will. And if you can store the information, then you can analyze it. And so that is worth being worried about. That is worth being concerned about. And it is stuff that we should talk about and encourage sort of public debate, about those kinds of things.
I just feel like we might be falling into the pit of techno panic when we do that.
You're a privileged white male, Leo.
Right.
We all are. We are all privileged white males. And we're very lucky, to be part of this non-diverse panel that doesn't have to worry about a lot of the economic consequences that affect people who aren't privileged white males like us.
Well said. Well said.
Okay.
Didn't mean to be,
I always ask you these questions because I want to be talked out of it, and I have yet to be talked out of it. Yeah. But I give you a chance every time. we'll see. We'll see. I feel like, there's probably lots of ways people are gathering information about us that we aren't aware of anyway.
Yeah.
I feel like I get value out of Google, and it's somewhat in Google's interest to not sell stuff to insurance companies because they want to keep getting information. And as soon as these imaginary harms, because they're currently imaginary, happen... your concern is it'll be too late to turn back the clock. My point is, if this does happen, then people are going to say, oh crap, well, don't use Google anymore, and they're out of business.
The trouble is that it's not just Google. There are dozens of companies that you've never heard of.
I agree, and it's happening like crazy.
That are collecting huge amounts of data, and they're buying databases, and they're using them to make decisions that affect people's lives.
That I agree with, but that's why I'm not worried about Google. Should we worry about Google?
Well, so, okay, so let's imagine, you know, let's play science fiction scenarios here. Google's doing great right now. They're making great money. But imagine that all of their moonshots fail. And all of a sudden, their advertising business starts to collapse in a couple years in the same way that Microsoft's Windows business collapsed.
But don't you think TransUnion, I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with the NSA gathering information. If the government turns against us, all that information is usable. I mean, we're in deep trouble anyway, I think. But look at TransUnion, Equifax. These companies know more about you than anybody, and they are using it against you all the time.
Right.
That's already happening. And whether you use Google or not makes no difference.
So just lie back and enjoy it?
Yeah, because Google gives me some value at least. Value the TransUnion, Equifax don't.
Well, again, the fact that you want to opt into that is
I feel like
awesome.
You're kind of fatalistic, and it's like you've given up. Maybe
no,
I've
no,
given
no.
up.
No, you're the one who's
oh,
fatalistic.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I'm the one who's given
you're
up.
You're the one who's fatalistic. You're the one who's saying, oh, you know, there's nothing we can do to stop them collecting this data, so we might as well just take advantage of the wonderful ads and...
Well, I wish the credit reporting agencies didn't exist, but they do. What am I supposed to do about that? Not use a credit card? Get off the grid?
Ed, why don't you use like DuckDuckGo or something,
I'm sure
like,
he does.
Something like this
I'm sure
rather,
he does.
Rather than Google?
DuckDuckGo really has inferior information sources. That's the problem.
Well, see, then I have problems with this because there's an ethical issue. It's like using an ad blocker. There's an ethical issue because you like Google better, but you're not willing to pay for it with your data.
Yeah.
Right?
That's the cost of Google. I use Bing for some things. I use Google for other things. But I also try to take advantage of perfectly legal techniques that allow information not to leave my computer.
Right.
And go
but
out
that's
onto the
cost of using the better search service called Google.
No.
Isn't it?
No. No, no, no. We could get lost in this. But go to... I'll pick on my own site right
You're
now.
You're a freeloader, Ed.
If 100% of people were like, Ed, it wouldn't work.
Go to ZDNet.com and, well, that's the argument that the advertising companies make is that the internet won't work if you don't allow us to collect every single bit of information that's out there. And what I'm saying is disclose, give us choices, give us transparency on the amount of information that's out there and stop indiscriminately collecting things and storing it.
I don't think Ed is a problem because people were all worked up about ad blockers destroying the web, and it never happened because even though
nobody uses them,
a fairly large number of people use them, they're still a small minority, and the business model still works if a small minority of people aren't seeing the ads.
But it's unethical to me. It's unethical. You're saying, I want to use your service for free, and what you're asking me is for ad impressions, and I'm not going to give them to
Google
you.
If Google really didn't want Ed to do it, they could make Ed agree not to do that. And as far as I know, Google doesn't do that.
Yeah, because they don't care. But it still doesn't mean it's not ethical.
And most of the reasons that people use ad blockers today have nothing to do with privacy and everything to do with
ads.
The god-awful experience that comes with having too many ads.
By the way, Google pulled Ad Blocker Plus from the Play Store.
Yeah.
For that very reason, apparently they don't like people blocking ads. Maybe they don't like it, really.
They're not crazy about it, but it's not destroying them. And
the internet. I think there's this impression that this should all be free, but hey, it's expensive to be Google. It ain't cheap.
Google's getting lots of information from me. I'm not. But what I don't do is stay signed into Google services and allow every single website that has Google Analytics or Google AdSense on it to collect information about me that I didn't enter into an agreement with them to give them. I don't see anything ethically problematic with that. When I go to Google, I'm signed in. They know who I am. You know. If I go and check Gmail, if I go to YouTube and post a comment, it's done with my real name.
You'd prefer not, though, right?
No. It's not that. It's not that at all. It's the 27 different tracking services on a single web page that are then taking information that I about me and trying to build a profile about me that's being stored in a million different places. This isn't tinfoil hat stuff. This is what's happening now.
I would point out that all four of us work in ad-supported media. I mean, that's how
we... I allow ads on the pages there. It's tracking, Leo. It's tracking and collection and storage of data. It's not advertising.
Well, I'm proud to say we do not track our viewers in any way.
See?
So I,
and guess what?
It works. Our ads work anyway.
Right.
Yeah.
You see, it's not about ads. It's about tracking.
Right. Yeah. Okay. I'll grant you that. Although all the advertisers on all of your pages do track, mine don't. you can't tell me that ZDNet does not have trackers on your page.
They have more trackers than most. ZDNet has and Tech Republic have more trackers than most websites do. I don't like it, there are products that I recommend for people to limit the amount of tracking that's out there. If I ran the network, I would run it differently, but I don't. I'm a contributor.
Right. I don't. You know, we're lucky because we don't need to track, and I don't want to track. It's an interesting.
Your ads actually really do work. I was thinking the other day of all the stuff that I've got introduced to from Twit.
Yeah, they're very effective.
The last time that I was on, I almost said this the last time I was on, so I'm glad you brought it up because I remember Squarespace I got introduced to.
Yep.
Audible I got reintroduced to. I remember Ford ran for a while, like the same year I ended up buying a Ford car. It was like Ford was advertising with you guys. Anyway.
One thing we do, and it's interesting, one of the reasons this comes up because I've been in this kind of debate with some people this week because we're doing our annual survey. So one of the things, the only thing we do is we do a survey every year. It's completely opt-in, and we invite you to do it at twit.tv/survey, where we try to get a better idea of who our audience is, what your interests are, what shows you listen to. None of that information goes... The only information that goes to advertisers is percentages. We don't even keep track of who you are or anything like that. But even if we did, that doesn't go to advertisers. But what goes to advertisers is, 78% of Twit listeners are males with an income of $150,000 or higher. That's the only kind of information that goes to them. And they want to know that information because they want us to get some idea of who they're advertising to. Although, frankly, I think the only thing that really matters to any advertiser is how much is it going to cost and how much money am I going to make? Yep. And as long as the second number is bigger than the first by a significant amount, they're happy.
Yep.
And, but they kind of, I think it's make work. The agencies, well, we can give you a chart that shows you who you're buying and what. Anyway, that's all we do. And in fact, if you'd like to take the survey, we'd appreciate it. twit.tv/survey. We do that once a year just so we get an idea of, and some of this actually goes back to programming. We pay attention to what you're interested in, what you watch, whether we need to do video and audio and stuff like that. And if it's too long or too invasive, you don't need to do it. It's quite all right. That is not part of the deal. However, the more you watch, the happier we are. If you missed anything this week, you missed a lot. Let's take a look.
Previously on Twit.
Oh, no, it's going to blow.
This is just like the Apple Watch event. All that buildup, but very little release.
Tech news today.
Microsoft announced yesterday that Windows 10 will be a free upgrade for current Windows users, even those running pirated versions of Windows.
Every other operating system is free now. Microsoft needs to make money somewhere else. Skype subscriptions, app sales.
Tech news tonight.
Looks like Mario the Plumber and Pokemon are finally being dragged, kicking and screaming into the smartphone world. Today, Nintendo announced a joint venture with Japanese company DNA to create new smartphone and tablet games using their most popular characters.
Security now.
What do you think of laptop manufacturers, even Apple, using USB Type-C for power? We've talked about bad USB before.
We're going to need a condom. A USB charging condom. As soon as someone has, I'll tell everybody.
You should do it. You should call it the SpinRite Power Condom.
Twit. Put down the keg and tap the twit.
Okay, it was St. Patrick's Day, all right? See, the power condom is a good idea. If anybody wants to use this on Kickstarter, the issue is these new Type-C connectors on both the Apple MacBook and on my new Pixel, they're not just power, they're data. So bad USB, which is the firmware hack that can, be used with USB to infect the system and infect other systems, could, in theory, if if you were at a coffee shop and you wanted to borrow some power, they could make it not just a power cord, but a data cord and infect you.
Yeah.
So his condom is brilliant. It's just a male to female type C connector with just two wires, the power wires and nothing, no data wires. And you just carry that around with you and whatever, you can use any charger you want because there's no data. I'm telling you, Kickstarter, you can make a million.
Kickstart that. Totally.
Kickstart that.
Somebody kickstart that tomorrow. Well,
that's a good show idea. Kickstart that. Our show.
That is a great show idea.
Kickstart that. We tried a show called I'd Fund That. And then if you didn't, so it was you had a crowdsource thing, and if we liked it, we'd say I'd fund that. And then if you didn't like it, we'd say go fund yourself. Didn't take off.
It was Shark Tank.
It's kind of a crowdsourced Shark Tank. Yeah.
Yeah.
Except I'm not investing any money. I'm not Mark Cuban. Our show today brought to you by Personal Capital. Hey, I love these guys. This was somebody I met, Ed Harris. He was one of the guys who started PayPal with Elon Musk. He and Elon Musk started PayPal. He knows a lot about finance, knows a lot about money. He was the CEO of Intuit. And he, you know, kind of watched what was going on in the world. He said, you know what the real problem is that people are investing. They're saving for retirement. That's not the issue. But they're not really paying attention to where their money is, what their money's doing. I think because they're all on different sites with different passwords, I think there needs to be an easy kind of financial dashboard that you can see, you know, what's happening to your money, track it, help you budget it, take a look at your 401k, make sure it's properly invested, that you're not paying too much in mutual fund loads or investment commissions, things like that. And this is so cool. And it's absolutely free. It's actually three different businesses. So let's start with the free and simple thing, which is merely go to personalcapital.com/twit and set it up so that you can now get this dashboard. You can see it on your computer, your tablet, your mobile device, your phone, the iOS and Android. They have apps. They even have apps for Android Wear watches. So you got all this information. You know where you stand. Absolutely free. It's really useful. You can make smarter financial decisions, rebalance your portfolio, things like that. Now, this is the second part of it, and they offer this as a freebie to you. If you're tracking accounts that add up to $100,000 in assets or more, they'll give you a free 30-minute review with one of their financial advisors. These are certified financial planners. They're not working on commission. In fact, this is totally free. So you can discuss your financial goals, your risk tolerance, time horizon. Really, for most people, that 30-minute checkup gives you the basis, the foundation to make sure you're planning for your retirement properly and your investments are optimized. Take control of your financial future. Personal Capital gives you total clarity and transparency so you can make better investment decisions right away. And if you put $100,000 or more in the assets in your dashboard, and by the way, that includes all your assets, your house, your car, your savings, you'll get that free 30-minute portfolio consultation. You can also invest through Personal Capital. That's the third part of the business. We'll talk about that another time. Just set up your free account right now, personalcapital.com/twit. Take advantage of that free 30-minute phone call or not. If not, just use the dashboard. It's great. personalcapital.com/twit. They are now tracking $120 billion in personal finances. That's pretty amazing. Pretty incredible. We are talking Twit with Jason Hiner of Tech Republic. Great to have you, Jason.
Always a pleasure.
In beautiful Louisville.
Hey, you can't wait. Remember.
I think I see the giant Louisville Slugger bat out back there. Is that what that is? No, it's
I wish it was. It's
not. Yes. That's the best thing. You've got Louisville Sluggers are in Louisville.
Yes.
Are you getting ready for the Derby?
Yes, Derby's coming up, you know, a little over a month away, weekend in May.
Yay. Awesome.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Do you do that? Do you get to put on a funny hat and you get your fascinator out?
You got to be a high roller to get to the Derby. Yeah. So, no. But Tech Republic actually, true story, Tech Republic actually during the dot-com boom when money was cheap, Tech Republic had a booth, a suite on Millionaire's Row. A huge, amazing suite on Millionaire's Row for the Derby. Of course, right? It was .com. It was VC money. So it was good times. Now I watch it on TV like the rest of them.
Yeah. Drinking a Pabst Blue Ribbon. A Miller High Life with your shoes off. It's good. Life is good. Tell us about the book real quick.
Yeah. So Follow the Geeks is the book that I'm working on with Lindsay Gilpin. We are co-authoring this book that's focusing on digital entrepreneurs, people who've had to figure out how to make it on their own. The thesis is that the future of work is a lot more entrepreneurial. And so we're finding people who have not followed a traditional career path, but had to go out and do interesting things. So chapter one, we're releasing them on the internet as we finish the chapters as well. So, and then the book itself will be published in the second half of the year, the whole thing. But as we finish the chapters, we're releasing them on the internet for free for a limited time, you know, one at a time. So chapter one was Baratunde, chapter two was Lisa Bettany, and chapter three, just released on Friday, is Gina Trapani.
Yay. And
already gotten so much wonderful feedback.
Oh, she's great.
Love Gina, you know, and she has such a great story. She's so self-effacing and, you know, doesn't brag about herself and her own story very much. So I was really glad that we were able to tell her story and to get it out there for people to see, you know, all the great stuff that she's done. So that one is available for free, will be available for free until chapter four is released, sometime next month.
That's so great. You did an Indiegogo initially for this, but
we did.
How did that work out for you?
Yeah, so the Indiegogo was good. What we did was we did that because we are self-publishing. The Indiegogo was about raising some money so that, you know, typically when you do a book, you get an advance. And so that advance pays for, you know, your time. It pays for different different things and to be able, your research costs to be able to go and do the book. And so we did the Indiegogo to cover research costs, but also to cover the cost of, you know, doing the initial print run for the book and the cost of hiring someone to do an audiobook, which we are doing an audiobook. We're going to release this in four forms, paperback, hardback, audiobook, and ebook. And so we also have to pay somebody to do the layout of the book, you know, and that kind of thing. And we raised enough to cover the basic costs of, you know, doing the book so that we can self-publish and we can sell directly to our readers. And, you know, we will sell through Amazon and other, outlets, but we're also selling it. We've opened pre-orders. You can pre-order the book in all of those four formats on our site, followthegeeksbook.com. And one of the things that we're doing as we release these chapters too, is like for Gina's, we're asking people to give us their feedback on, you know, what they think was most significant in Gina's story and what, they think, you know, the most important impact she had and what insights other people can learn about navigating the digital world of the future and the future of work, you know, from her story. And then we're going to take the best insights and we're going to publish those at the end of each chapter in the final version.
Oh, that's neat. That's neat. Well, it's so everybody who, you know, watches Twit knows Gina very well. And it's really fun to read her story, which I did not know. So as has been the case with all three of these chapters, I know all three of them and I learned a lot about all three of them. So it's great. The book is, you can read chapter by chapter, but you got to read it when it comes out because it's not going to be out for long. Followthegeeksbook.com. Chapter three is all about Gina Trapani.
Yes. And also at Follow the Geeks on Twitter, you can find all the updates there as well.
Good. I will be buying this book the minute it comes out. I can't wait. Yeah. Thank you, Jason Hiner. Also here for the Technologizer, Harry McCracken. You enjoying Fast Company?
I'm having a great time.
Yeah.
It's a real cool place.
I really like Fast Company. It was a print magazine, right?
It still is. I just finished our cover story for our next issue.
They're still printing?
We have a magazine which is doing well and newsstand sales are up.
Good.
It's kind of weird to be working for a print publication, which is actually doing just fine in 2015.
I think this, because it's enterprise-focused or...
Oh, you know, we put up together a really good product. There are magazines out there where their reaction to it being challenging to publish a magazine is to do it as cheaply as possible.
Right.
We do a really high-quality magazine that people care about. And a lot of the time I go out and I meet people and they say, I subscribe to one magazine. That magazine is Fast Company.
That's great.
And we have a great website, with way more content than you could ever put in print.
Is that the Tim Stevens? Or is that a different Tim Stevens?
On our website?
Yeah. Is he writing for you guys?
If he is, it's news to me, although it'd be really cool.
Yeah. Nice. Fastcompany.com.
Tim Stevens still works for CNET.
That's what I thought. So it must be another... I guess it's kind of like a name it could mean.
Happily steal Tim Stevens.
I know. Who wouldn't? Tim Stevens, don't we love Tim Stevens? Yep. And from ZiffDavis.net, ZDNet.com.
No, 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 no,
ZDCom.net. What is it?
Not Ziff Davis.
It's not Ziff Davis, and it's net.com, not com.net.
We go through this, ZDNet is not Ziff Davis.
I know, I know, I know.
There was this grand fracturing of the universe.
I was there for it. I remember it well.
Back at the turn of the century, you were there.
Yeah, I remember those. And former editor-in-chief at Windows Magazine, right?
Leo.
I'm sorry, PC use, PC.
PCC.
PCC. PC computing. I know, it's one of them. You know what? Nobody cares anymore. It's all just a stack of paper in some library.
It really is. Although I have to say, I just signed up for a 3-year subscription to Fast Company based on Harry joining them.
Oh,
that's good news.
Dead serious. Tell the circulation department.
We saw the uptick when you subscribed.
Every subscriber counts.
There was a blip there. No, ZDNet is we're a sister site of Jason's Tech Republic.
Right.
Yes.
Same management under CBS Interactive. A very, very good company to work for. I really enjoy the people that I work with. And
nice.
The content that we do is diverse and interesting. And they give me a lot of freedom to write a lot of stuff that makes me happy. So I like it.
Facebook's F8 conference coming up this week. That's the big developer conference. Do we have any prognosis, any predictions as to what might be happening? It's an interesting company to watch because they're very forward-thinking. Mark Zuckerberg seems to be very smart, and they seem to be pushing the envelope in a lot of ways.
They have two keynotes. The second keynote looks like it's all Oculus. And if we're lucky, it'll be some of the details about the consumer launch of Oculus that we still don't know.
I have seen the future of VR, and it's pornography. I'm not kidding you at this point. Now, I know, everybody, snigger away. I have been to the VR store. We always say that technologies like VHS, DVD get forwarded, the web get pushed forward.
Chat rooms
by adult entertainment. And I have to say, I was a little skeptical on this whole VR thing. The Oculus Rift makes me a little queasy. And that's because I was playing video games, right? But somebody showed me, I'm not going to name names, but somebody said, Leo, look at this. And I was actually using the Galaxy Gear VR, but it's Oculus technology. It's similar technology. And there is a site, probably more than one at this point, that makes VR movies, adult movies, and there it is. It's like being there. and the minute I saw it, I realized, oh my God, nobody knows about this yet. But when this happens, forget Call of Duty. I got Call of Booty. Have any of you tried this stuff? No, you would never admit it. I am. I see. This is. Go ahead, ask me all the questions you've got. Go ahead. I know you're thinking about this.
That probably will not be the big news at F8.
but you got to think that they are aware of this and that they are thinking a little bit. Now, it's interesting because in the HD DVD versus Blu-ray wars, there was a little blip there because HD DVD prevented adult entertainment. Who survived that war?
I mean, way back when, I think AOL knew about a lot of the stuff people were doing on AOL. And while they did not promote it, they also did not prevent it.
That's the key. Turn a blind eye. I have to say, until you... All right, I don't know what to say anymore. I'm not going to spend a lot of time in a VR helmet. I'm telling you that right now. But until you've experienced it, It's hard to imagine how realistic it is. Now, I suppose the same would be true of other things, but I can't think of, like, you don't really want to be immersed in the Superman movie. You don't want it to be a first-person experience. I guess maybe flying or something, but that's a limited thing. There's one form of entertainment that naturally lends itself to this, and that's porno. All right, I'm sorry I brought it up, but I'm just telling you, you heard it here first. So that won't be part of the Facebook announcement.
Most likely not.
But what are they going to talk about? Gaming?
There's a lot of, I mean, there's platform stuff. It's a developer conference, so presumably right. It will be about apps. They still have not talked about the pricing or the exact release date. And then the first day of F8 is general Facebook news, and the big thing they're talking about is Messenger starting to be a platform.
What does that mean, turn Messenger into a platform? John Constein wrote about this on TechCrunch.
Payments.
That's one thing they're going to do. But we already have Venmo and other systems for doing that, right? Is this going to be different from that? Can't you do payments in WhatsApp, or is that not yet out?
Not that I'm aware of.
No, they were going to do that, but maybe they haven't done it yet. All right, payments. WeChat does it, right? Line, I think, does.
Line is a payment service.
Does it, yep. Yeah. But those are Asia, very Asia-specific. So payments would be one. But, you know, it's so funny because you see, that's the other side of the coin. I gave high praise to Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook's intelligence. And yet you've seen them launch apps that have just sunk without a trace time and time again. Poke. There've been like three apps that just went nowhere recently. And I can't even remember the name anymore. What's another Facebook app?
Home was one of them,
home,
right?
The home screen for Android.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
That was a flop.
Wasn't there a Facebook camera as well?
They keep doing this stuff, and it just doesn't grab. So you can do whatever you want. I think
Paper, which I love. But it's
Paper's great.
It's not setting the world on fire.
Nobody uses it.
It's a really good app.
Hey, guys.
Yeah?
I got to go. My bus is here.
Oh, Ed, all right. His ride's waiting for me. Yeah, this has gone on way too long. Thank you, Ed.
It's been a pleasure.
Okay. Larry Page's helicopter is waiting for his black helicopter's right out there. Just watch out, okay?
Take care. I'll Uber my way.
Ed Bott, ZDNet.com. He's the greatest. Come back.
And goodbye.
What do you think he meant when he said his ride was waiting?
Boss.
Mm.
One of his dogs, probably.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, probably a dog.
You guys know more about Ed than I do. Have you been looking at his Google feed? Facebook's got a challenge, doesn't it? It's rapidly becoming your parents' social network.
I mean, you mentioned Line. Line is making a fortune from third parties and content. And using messaging as a platform for all kinds of entertainment, and maybe Facebook is watching that and wants to do something comparable.
Line made money in stickers, as all the Asian messaging apps did. And I actually set up Line and played with it. It's kind of fun. They've got a bear, but they've got like characters
they
that you like.
Brown and Coney and
all those a bunny guys. And a bear. And then now they have Line Pay.
They have a taxi service.
Interesting. Like an Uber style?
Like over the last couple of months, they've announced almost any service that anybody does. Line has announced they're going to do a Line version about they're delivering meals.
But they live in a different world because they live in a world where the phone is much more central still than it is here, right? In Asia, I think the phone, the phone is a more primary computing platform. That will change in the U.S. soon.
But we're not that far behind anymore.
Right. So Facebook wants to be part of that. All right, well, we'll watch. F8 is this week. What's the other keynote about?
I think it's one keynote about general Facebook stuff and one keynote about Oculus stuff.
All right, we're going to run real quickly. Pwn to Own in Vancouver, the big CanSec West security conference. They do this every year. I feel like it's a little sketch. The teams of security researchers collect exploits. But they don't reveal them to the companies or to the public because they want it to be their secret advantage at Pwn to Own. There's a chance to win a lot of money. And in fact, a South Korean researcher on Thursday, Jung-hun Lee, his team, he was by himself, but his online name is Lockheart, won $225,000 and a couple of laptops by hacking Internet Explorer 11 and Google Chrome on Windows, as well as Safari on OS 10. They use these exploits, usually chained exploits, a variety of different exploits all chained together to own those systems. After the event is over, the way it works, you probably know, the contest sets up 64-bit versions of the top operating systems with the top browsers, and then the teams go at them. And if you can hack it, you win the laptop and some cash. His attack on Google Chrome earned him the largest payout in the history of the competition for a single exploit. He got $75,000 for finding a Chrome bug, an extra $25,000 for a privilege escalation to system, another $10,000 for hacking the browser's beta version, $110,000 on Chrome alone, then another $65,000 for IE11, and $50,000 for Safari. The reason I think it's sketch is these guys are coming up with exploits but don't reveal them until after the event. So you're incenting people to find exploits. I guess in the long run you get them. I just worry that these exploits will become public knowledge before Pwn.own. The final count for vulnerabilities, 5 flaws in Windows OS, 4 in IE11, 3 each in Firefox, Adobe Reader and Flash Player, 2 in Safari and 1 in Chrome. So basically there's no safe platform. You can be hacked on any platform.
Oh, yeah.
Pwn.own. Speaking of hacking, greatfire.org, which is a really interesting organization that is doing the best it can to reveal what the Chinese, the Great Firewall of China, the Chinese government are keeping from their people. They are under attack. The Chinese government named them as an anti-China website. And now they're under a DDoS attack. They wrote on Thursday, at this time of writing, 2.6 billion requests per hour, costing them $30,000 a day in extra fees from their internet service provider. And, of course, bringing the site down. And all their mirrors, too.
Wow.
Yeah, that's bad. I don't know what the current state is. I could log in. We've mentioned stories from them before. They're really very good about keeping a track of what's going on in China. Let's see if they come up. Yeah, they came up. But it's cost them a lot of money to stay up. This is the blog post. We are under attack. Mm. I think I've worn you guys out, haven't I? Or are you just waiting to get off so you can go download some VR porn? All right. Well, I'll tell you what. Let's just wrap this up in a second. All right. Our show today brought to you by Carbonite Online Backup. You got to be backing up to get your data, to protect it, to keep it safe. Carbonite Automatic Cloud Backup, round the clock protection. And I want to emphasize, it's great not just for individual users. We talk about that all the time. I use it and I tell you about it, but also for business owners. Carbonite, if you're a hands-on business owner, makes data backup hands-free and hassle-free. Backs up all your digital assets to the cloud automatically and securely. More than 1.5 million people trust Carbonite. 70,000 businesses for around-the-clock protection of their business files, their databases, and documents. And you know what? It's affordable. It's easy. If you're using it at home, you should try it at your business. Cloud backup done right. These guys, I know them well, and they've really got a commitment to finding a solution that works for you. Take a look at Carbonite.com. Some great case, actually it's now 75,000 businesses. Some great case studies. And by the way, if you use the offer code TWIT when you sign up for the trial, you'll get 2 free bonus months when you decide to buy. So that's all I ask. Just use the offer code TWIT at Carbonite.com. If you're not using it, maybe the time has come. People are being pwned all the time. French government blocking websites. You saw the Charlie Hebdo free speech marches, people going linked armed and armed, promoting free speech. And then the French government decides to start blocking websites, not merely terrorist websites. And this is always the problem, isn't it? But in fact, websites that just have stuff that they don't like.
Which they've been doing all along.
Yeah.
Yep. Slippery slope. Once you that's why there's freedom of speech is guaranteed.
And there's no court review, no adversarial process. 5 websites were blocked in France, and you get a scary government website saying you're being redirected to this official website since your computer was about to connect with a page that provokes terrorist acts or condones terrorism publicly. Maybe that'd be okay if it were true, but many
doesn't
of these
sound like it's true.
No, many of these sites are merely like Islamic-news.info, Islamic news sites. Like the owner of that site says, I was never contacted to remove whatever material they were talking about, but I've never supported terrorism. In fact, We've been very clear. We don't support ISIS or Al-Qaeda at all. We're not, they're not fans, I guess, of Bashar al-Assad, the president of Syria, but who is? That's not a reason to block it. He says, I don't share ISIS propaganda or similar content. In fact, we've even denounced folks who promote attacks on Europe. But they just shut him down. That's too bad. That's sad.
Not good.
Not good. Read Harry's article on PlayStation View. I'm interested in that. I'm going to have to try it.
Yeah.
Do I need a PlayStation 4? Can I do that on PlayStation 4?
Actually, unless you have some pull with Sony.
Oh, it's a beta deal?
Well, you need to be in New York or Philadelphia or Chicago right now. Another cool thing they have is they have local stations, which is why they're city by city. They have lots of broadcast TV as well as cable channels.
See, that's the key. I could get most of what I want over the internet. It's the live stuff I can't, the broadcast stuff.
Yeah.
And we're too far north. We can't get San Francisco stations. So I could watch The Voice on this.
You can't get it over the air? You can't get over the air from San Francisco?
We're just a little bit too far.
Man.
I guess if I had a big TV, antenna on the hillside or something.
Big monster antenna up there.
Yeah, I'm not going to do that. That's why God invented cable. And God did invent cable. I don't know if people really know that, but... all right, I've bored you enough. Go home and find something to watch on your VR helmet. Jason Hiner, don't forget the book, followthegeeksbook.com. Great to have you, Jason.
Thank you. Always a pleasure. And great suspenders, by the way.
Yeah, it's in honor of a spring training. It's the opening day for Major League Baseball.
Yes, indeed.
Suspenders, commemorative suspenders. Awesome. I had to take off my sweater when I started getting hot flashes. Apparently, I'm menopausal.
Your color looks much better.
I'm fine now.
You look great.
I was bright red before the show began. I think I was having a hot flash. It is that time. Harry McCracken, nice to see you.
Good to see you. Always
give our love to Marie.
Wait, well, for sure.
Great to see you. I follow you on Instagram and Twitter, so I always see you all. You're busy, busy doing stuff.
She said to
apologize
for not being here, but she had to take our cat to the vet.
Oh, I hope everything's okay.
He's fine.
All right. Thank you for being here, too. And we have a great live audience if you want to be here. Don't forget, April 19th is a very special broadcast. That is our 10th anniversary TWIT. I can't believe that. First TWIT was April 17th, 20. I don't even think you say 20. It was so long ago. 2005. And all of the original cast members and a few extras will be here. John C. Dvorak, he wasn't on the first show. Kevin Rose, Patrick Norton, David Prager, Robert Herron, and we're still waiting to hear from Roger Chang.
Yeah, we still got a maybe on Roger Chang.
Put the pressure on the Jolly Roger. No, that's all right. If you can't make it, that's all right. We got a pretty good cast. And if you would like to be here, tickets will be at a premium. A lot of people are bringing like their copies of Tech TV memorabilia and stuff. They'd like to get autographs and so forth. So do please email tickets at twit.tv because there will be limited supply on those. We can only get a fire marshal won't let us jam this place too tight. But for any other show, no, there's always empty seats. Ticket at twit.tv. Tickets at twit.tv. Please send us an email. If you can't be here in person, you can watch live. We're on 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern time. That would be 2200 UTC. And we go for several hours after that. Sometimes 5 hours, sometimes six. We just keep going. But do tune in live. If you can't, you can download on demand audio or video from our website, twit.tv, and from wherever podcasts live on the cloud or use one of our great apps. Either way, make sure you subscribe because we want you to get every single episode. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time. Another Twit is in the can. Thank you.